Sorry.
I can't get the microphone to work, sorry. Okay. It's my pleasure to introduce our second speaker on the panel in curating, which is Gerard McMaster from OCAD in Toronto. And Gerard is going to interrogate the question of the applicability or relevance of the ethnographic museum to contemporary Indigenous practices within the decolonialist turn. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks to Georgiana, to Annika, to Cora, and everyone else involved in organizing the conference. I'm going to be showing many, many images up here, so bear with me. I know that I was cautioned to speak rather slowly, but because I have to cover so much ground, I'm going to talk a little bit faster, all right? So enjoy the, I don't know if you can turn down the lights so you can see the images quite nicely. So the first one. Prior to the 1990s, and with the exception of Inuit art, Canadian art museums took little interest in collecting and exhibiting non-Western art. Ethnographic museums, on the other hand, were always interested in this cultural being, in other words, the artist as native. During the 1990s, however, Indigenous voices began influencing ethnographic museums to change. In addition, art museums began taking notice of Indigenous contemporary artists. Influenced by artists who were experimenting and discovering new forms and therefore began critiquing the institutions that accepted them. As well, their art now began to be acceptable by art museums, so Indigenous artists rapidly shifted away from ethnic collective representation by identity to one of complete individualism. With such a decolonial shift, the question must be asked, can ethnographic museums ever become relevant to Indigenous artists again? In the late 19th century, the governments of Canada and the United States instituted policies of rapid assimilation that severely weakened most, if not all, Indigenous cultures through an enforced modernity. The Canadian government forbade cultural expressions by outlawing all forms of cultural and spiritual practices, rendering many objects to lose their value, function, and meaning. As these objects rapidly disappeared from Indigenous communities, the cultural practices and languages of the object disappeared. Sadly, their original purpose did not endure. In the wake of the systemic discontinuity, massive quantities of tribal objects no longer useful, and many ended up in numerous public and private collections to be forever seen as artifacts. But in museum collections, these objects acquired new identities as commodity, artifact, specimen, art, heirloom, treasured cultural objects, or as sacred emblem. In the 1970s, we began witnessing a profound interest by Indigenous communities in seeing their objects, particularly the sacred and sensitive, returned to them, as we just heard from the Maori. The Yomista Cultural Center, located in the north end of British Columbia's Vancouver Island in the town of Alert Bay, has become a significant for the decisive role in repatriating objects back to their communities. It was a new kind of museum operated by Indigenous peoples. James Clifford, who many of you heard yesterday, says, "This story of repatriation seemed to be a striking example of how the dominant practice of collecting and display has been turned to unanticipated ends. Master narratives of cultural disappearance and salvage could be replaced by stories of revival, remembrance, and struggle." In the early 20th century, the early 20th century model for presenting Indigenous cultures endure, however, into the present. Located in Crazy Horse, South Dakota, this museum is dedicated to the famed Lakota warrior Crazy Horse, in the same state where current protests of oil are taking place. The museum itself is in contradistinction to, say, the Yomista Cultural Center. Here, there is no sense of display techniques or cultural sensitivity. It is not any different from cabinets of curiosity displays of another period. Meanwhile, national museums began changing with the times. Here, the Canada's National Museum, the Canadian Museum of Civilization, shows an introductory section to its 2,500 square meter exhibition, The First People's Hall. Completed in 2002, it is profoundly different from the Crazy Horse Museum. After a task force on museums and First Peoples was released in 1994, releasing a document that pressured all Canadian museums, the Canadian Museum of Civilization instituted an advisory council of First Nations from all across the country in conjunction with museum curators. This all came about as a result of the disastrous reception of the 1988 exhibition called The Spirit Sings, an Olympic exhibition that received criticism from the Indigenous community for its lack of Indigenous voice. Open in 2004, the Smithsonian National Museum of the American Indian became a huge presence on the Washington Mall. This recent image shows one of its newer displays in its New York branch. In this installation, from the exhibition, The Infinity of Nations, the museum gives the visitors what it wants, lots and lots of beautiful objects. However, with so much more money and expertise, is it any different from the Crazy Horse Museum I just showed? Whereas Crazy Horse Museum presents Lakota life and history, the National Museum of the American Indian presents the cultures of the Americas. It is more a world cultures museum of Indians, as we now know it in Europe. So-called indigenous artifacts, such as these ones are now routinely shown in art museums all across North America. But yet I still have problems with how such objects are displayed. This exhibition called Indigenous Beauty at the Toledo Art Museum states that it celebrates the visionary creativity and technical mastery of Native North American artists from tribes all across the continent. It's as if it still needs to make the argument to be accepted. As I said, prior to the 1990s, art museums paid little or no attention to collecting or exhibiting Indigenous contemporary art. They left it to ethnographic museums who have had a long interest in the cultural other. By the late 1980s and the early 90s, however, after constant pressure on art museums to take them seriously, a number of Indigenous contemporary artists began critiquing the ethnographic museum. Jimmy Durham created some of the most interesting and critical primitivist works. Among them is his humorous work titled Types of Arrows, on loan from the Museum of the American Indian. Labeled tiny, wavy, short, and fat, Durham targets the way the Museum of the American Indians exhibition presented objects in such impersonal and simplistic ways, terms, and in such an aesthetically unappealing fashion, and that Indigenous cultures looked almost childlike. It is a critique of the positivist examination of cultures by one proto-ethnographic museum, New York's Museum of the American Indian. Now it is the Smithsonian National Museum of the American Indian in Washington, D.C. James Luna introduced what most agree is the most profound work of his generation, or of its generation, called the Artifact Piece. It was introduced at the San Diego Museum of Men among its permanent exhibition in 1987. The Artifact Piece prompted diverse reactions from the observers who stared it as body as artifact. They were attracted to its reality effect. Only the occasional movement of his belly belied the body as object, which evidenced its identity as a living being. The museal discourse compelled viewers to treat it as an object, thus relegating it to a third-person status. Luna, the artist, is rendered powerless and excluded until, of course, he decides to get up and walk away. At that point, he renders the viewer suddenly self-conscious as they realize that they are now the spectacle. The observer is now on view and becomes other. There is little evidence that Luna changed any attitudes. It may very well be that the public's identification of Indians or Native Americans as past and savage was clarified a little during this time. Nevertheless, Luna has influenced the discursive space of ethnographic museums, which by their presentations had to reconsider their power relations. In this new series, for example, Luna, who lives on the La Jolla Indian Reservation near San Diego in Southern California, but rarely shows locally, juxtaposes image of himself next to the historical photos of Ishii, the so-called, as museums called him at that time, the last member of the Yana tribe of Northern California. Ishii was part of the vanishing Indian discourse of the early 20th century. Luna calls these photos in the show performographs, performance art captured with a camera. Rebecca Belmore represented Canada at the 2005 Venice Biennale. She is best known for her performance and installation works. In Artifact 671B, which is her treaty number, she presents herself as an artifact framed within a box structure. And like Luna, several signs surround her. It was done in solidarity with Indigenous peoples who protested the Spirit Sings exhibition at the Glenbow Museum during the 1988 Olympics, Winter Olympics. The success of this work, I would argue, is because of the support of her people who can be seen standing behind her. Her performance and performances are political theater. Jainash Putra, criticizing the use and abuse of the Indian body politic as a casualty of modernity. In this work, she uses the museological technique of the display case as metaphors for seduction, change, and conversion. She suggests the frailties as examples of the problems and conflicts that are a constant threat to Indigenous community life. But after the fragmentation and disintegration that signified the reservation period, Indigenous people are now finding themselves in radically new dispositions of renewal, affirmation, and self-determination. In this case, called Assimilation Indian, Assimilated Indian presents the dangers of habits and addiction in which addiction signifies death. The skeleton reaches for a can of beer while hovering over a field of cigarette butts. Drinking among Indigenous peoples has long been a sign of resistance to counter the pain of existence and the conditions of poverty. But abuse of intoxicants has, of course, far greater consequences for the individual and his or her social network. The idea of assimilation has also been very much part of the anthropological discourse describing the Indigenous state of affairs, a kind of longing for the past, while at the same time being absorbed into the great body politic of the West. Joan Cardinal Schubert was inspired to create this work called Is This My Grandmother? By a visit to the research collections of the Canadian Museum of Civilization. She asks, what kind of possessions do Native people have of their grandparents and great-grandparents? None, she answers. They're all in drawers in Ottawa. During one particular visit, she saw in the museum's storage vaults many objects stuffed into clear plastic bags, not realizing that this practice of preventative care, she had a spontaneous adverse reaction. Since many of the objects are made of organic material, storing them this way prevents insect infestation. As Indigenous peoples try to become more aware of the historical circumstances that led to the removal of millions of objects from communities across the Americas that now sit lifelessly in storage facilities around the world, the question for Indigenous communities has been, how can life be brought back to these objects? I shared that little story yesterday of the song. In those early days, museums and other institutions often spoke for Indigenous people what I call ventriloquism. This throwing of one's voice did not sit well with Indigenous people. It took great effort to change this landscape, and this move was led by Indigenous artists. According to Haida legend, Raven, the cultural hero, found himself one day on the Rose Spit Beach on Haida Gwaii in Vancouver Island. Suddenly, he saw himself in an extraordinary clamshell at his feet, and protruding from it were small creatures. Raven coaxed them to leave the shell to join him in his wonderful world. Some were hesitant at first, but eventually, overcome curiosity, they emerged from the partly open clamshell to become the first Haida. Bill Reed's monumental sculpture, seen here, the Raven and the First Man, brings life back to the Haida. It began as a miniature boxwood carving inspired by the works of late 19th century Haida artist Charles Eden Shaw. For several years, when I worked, I held a curatorial position at the Canadian Museum of Civilization, a non-art museum, as I said. I worked with ethnologists, archaeologists, folklorists, historians, and an Inuit art curator. This museum opened its new building in 1989 with a dedicated gallery for showing contemporary Indigenous works. During this time I experienced the dilemma for most, if not all, Indigenous artists, that of being shown in a non-art museum. The question was, however, answered by Edward Potra, an artist who I curated at the 1985 Venice Biennale. He said that he did not mind being in a museum because he felt he was closer to his ancestors there, as they were not in an art museum. It was also in the late 1980s and early 90s that the Canadian Museum of Civilization began commissioning major Indigenous artists, as seen here. Bill Reed's Killer Whale on the lower left is one of the three major works on this site, and the one on the right is Alex Janvier's Morning Star. This is a close-up of the Morning Star, painted as a commentary on the clash of cultures that took place between Europeans who had arrived in North America and who had encountered Indigenous peoples. It is approximately 7 stories high from the floor, and it is 19 meters or 62 feet in diameter and covers 418 square meters or 4,500 square feet. It's a rather large and impressive piece. Currently at the National Gallery of Canada, Janvier is the subject of a major retrospective, so you may want to Google that. The curator there at the National Gallery is now the head of a Department of Indigenous Art. In 1992, while the world was celebrating the Columbian Quincentennial, Indigenous peoples were the exception. Indigenous people as a political force were still relatively unknown. I curated an exhibition called Indigena as an anti-celebration exhibition, and in which only Indigenous voice was present. As is evidenced in the image on the right, we marketed an exhibition that was very, very hard-hitting. Though the name might make you cringe, UBC Museum of Anthropology, it is still a great and beloved institution in the city of Vancouver, regularly showing exhibitions of historical, traditional, and contemporary art. Its building is by a renowned architect. Its collections are presented as art, and its program varies between art and anthropology. It comes closest to the European phenomena of the World Cultures Museum. In 2005, the Smithsonian National Museum of the American Indian opened its museum on the famed Washington Mall. Susan Point, a Canadian artist, will forever be immortalized within the walls of the museum when she was commissioned by the Canadian government to do this piece, which is now on permanent display at the museum entrance. And here she is being interviewed by several of the national media at the time. Salish art is not well known as it should be, she says, but by settling our Salish footprint upon the DC land, she said, this is an example of artistry and cultural reverence will be acknowledged and honored for generations to come. In their New York branch of the National Museum of the American Indian, it routinely presents contemporary Indigenous art. This work by Alan Michelson is an immersive 4-channel video installation, and it's called Two Row. And its purple tinted projections operate as two films going down the river this way in opposite directions. but they embody a 17th century agreement between the Iroquois Confederacy, or the Haudenosaunee people as they call themselves, and the Dutch of the day. Evoking the river as metaphor for contact and coexistence, Michael merges two contrasting cultural traditions, European tourist panoramas and the Iroquois wampum belt. Next, we move on to a more than a critique or presentation in ethnographic museums, to where artists use the collections to their own ends. In other words, harnessing their own voice, often using humor and irony. In this work by Rosalie Fafel, she says, "I inserted myself into the painting by the American Victorian collector Charles Wilson Peel. The original painting links natural history and museum practices that included collecting Aboriginal peoples and artifacts. In order to disrupt this colonial view, I inserted aspects of my cultural heritage into this museum." For Favel, the work is a statement about Indigenous peoples claiming the right to exhibit their own culture and history. For Peel, the painting links natural history and museum practices that included collecting Aboriginal peoples and artifacts. Okay. Kent Monkman, known for his painting, film, and performance imagery, challenged the ethnographic accuracy attributed to the representation of Indians. His work reshapes the history of colonization and North American landscape under the guise of his alter ego, Mischief Eagle Testicle. This painting, entitled Duel After the Masquerade, is based on a 19th century painter, Paul Kane's Medicine Mask Dance. Monkman's painting takes its title, though, from the mid-19th century painter, French artist Jerome, which depicts a defeated man dressed in Pierrot costume slumping into the arms of his friends, while his adversary dressed in an Indian costume departs from the scene. Here, Monkman shows the artist Paul Kane being held up by the masked Indigenous dancers in an environment not of their own, but elsewhere. His easel lies on the ground as he looks in astonishment as Mischief strides away in a white fur coat. In the background of this work by Nicholas Gallinan, he combines an image of Edward Curtis photography with that of the Star Wars Princess Leia. White Carver is an unusual installation that includes the performer named Ed, who is a well-dressed Caucasian man with an eager face as he sits on a platform behind a velvet rope working on a carving. He is making a wood carving that conforms to the traditional Northwest Coast art. A large photograph of Ed is caught looking at the camera as he begins a new stroke, though we do have the stump that supports the drawings that he's using for his copy. Gallinan has a personal experience with this stereotype when he once worked as a carver at the Cultural Center in Sitka, Alaska. Greg Deal's Ethnographic Zoo is a performance piece conceived to deconstruct the commodification and consumption of the Indigenous image is done outside the Denver Art Museum. Much of the performance art deals in stereotype appropriation and the troubling amount of authority that both exert over Indigenous identity, shaping the ways in which people understand and interact with both images and Indigenous peoples. The concept of the ethnographic or human zoo is rooted in early museums. These cabinets of curiosities, oddities that exist in the world, are foreign and mysterious to the Western eye. It was during this time that tribal people from Africa, the Philippines, and the Americas, and other exotic places were put on display, museumified studies, and gawked at. The sign outside the velvet rope that is not seen here, it says, "Please do not feed the stereotype." Finally, and I'll be very quick, we shift from the ethnographic zoo to the art museum, where both art and artists have now confirmed their status as Canadian artists. Our National Gallery of Canada is where I said just a few minutes ago that our most senior First Nations artist, Alex Janvier, is having his retrospective. He is not the first nor the last artist to gain such notoriety. Carl Beam must be given that particular status for having this work collected in 1985. The work is called North American Iceberg, and it was a reaction to a major exhibition of the same title, or actually it was not the same title, but it was the title European Iceberg that appeared just the year before at the Art Gallery of Ontario. At the time when this was collected, he seemed particularly annoyed because he had hoped that he was being collected as Carl the artist rather than Carl the Indian artist. Unfortunately, it seems that one of the labels has stuck. Nonetheless, Carl was given a posthumous retrospective in 2010. As I said earlier, the entire Western universe was celebrating the Columbus Quincentennial in 1992. The National Gallery produced this exhibition that brought together Indigenous artists from Canada and the United States. 15 years later, in 2007, the National Gallery announced the hiring and appointment of its first Indigenous art curator, Greg Hill, himself an Indigenous person. Now he runs an Indigenous art department. The National Gallery has since collected works of rising Indigenous artists, such as this work by Brian Youngen, whose 2006 exhibition traveled to such notable exhibition places such as London's Tate Modern and Rotterdam's Witt de Witt. Robert Houle, in this exhibition called Paris Ojibwe, brings the drama of North American natives visiting the courts of 19th century Europe in a remarkable tableau vivant, or living picture, that recalls a French salon. Houle's inspiration came from the mid-19th century portraits of native North Americans by the French painter Eugène Delacroix. He was drawn to the story of a group of Ontario Ojibwes who were invited to perform for European courts in the 1840s. Nadja Mir presented this 24-meter-long photograph in the National Gallery's hallway. The title of this work was inspired by the declaration bed read by the Algonquin grandmothers on Parliament Hill on June 11, 2013. The piece consists of a long black and white beaded belt, similar in content to that of Allan Michelson I showed a moment ago. Like the movement Idle No More, the grandmothers demanded greater respect for Indigenous peoples as well as those who could not speak or cannot speak, namely the earth, the water, animals, and future generations. I began work in 2005 at the Art Gallery of Ontario as the head of Canadian art, and I was responsible for the rehang of the entire Canadian galleries, which included greater representation of women and First Nations art. I also brought in contemporary art to hang alongside historic collections. And one of the artists I brought in was Kent Monkman. Though this wasn't the work that I brought in, it's still a good example of the kind of work that we commissioned to be presented in the Art Gallery of Ontario. It was installed in the Central Gallery, and it's called Salon Indien, and consists of the teepee, as you see here, inside of which is a heavy Victorian parlor drapery with a video running called The Group of 7 Inches, a silent movie theater that is a homoerotic critique of ethnography. The entire installation revels in campy fun, undercutting the serious undertow of colonial language. And finally, just some images of the kinds of work that we presented in the Canadian galleries. As I said, we wanted to do a new Canadian narrative without the usual references to any traditional Canadian antecedents, which were generally from Europe. Instead, we wanted to tell the story of Canadian art that began not 150 years ago, but 11,000 years ago. This projectile point installation was installed to ask the question, is it art? A video in the background you see here included many voices attempting to answer the question. Stone objects or projectile points are usually relegated to archaeological displays, as we're all very familiar. Now the only surviving thing from a long time ago. Just some examples of works that we used and some of the techniques of juxtaposition that was talked about yesterday. We intermix historic objects with contemporary art. We also juxtapose indigenous work with European, Euro-Canadian works, as you see here. Basically, we wanted to show that both types of artists were looking at the very same landscape. So finally, I'm just going to run. I won't speak about these until the final image. Just give you an idea of the kinds of works that we presented. This was 2008. To conclude, indigenous voices have influenced ethnographic museums to change, while art museums began taking notice of indigenous contemporary artists. This decolonial shift has, however, left ethnographic museums to wonder if they will ever be relevant to indigenous artists again. Thank you.
Thank you, Jared, for an incredibly generous and dense presentation. In the interests of time, does MJ have a sort of urgent question that they would like to address or comment or observation for Jared in relation to his presentation?
There's nothing urgent. That's great.
There's quite a lot of urgencies. Can I ask one thing?
Yes, of course.
At the beginning of your presentation, you made this observation around a shift from collectivity to individualization, which we could read through a neoliberal filter, in a sense. And I'd like you to maybe extrapolate a little bit more on what your thinking around that was, that there is this shift towards individualization is taking place here.
Following the project Indigena in 1992, in which we brought artists from all across Canada, we felt up until that point it seemed that exhibitions with Indigenous artists were group exhibitions. And that's how they were seen, as group exhibitions. And Native art exhibitions, Indigenous art exhibitions, Indian art exhibitions, there was little or no individuality in that. So we felt that this exhibition would more than likely be the last exhibition of its kind. In other words, group exhibitions, or should be the last of its kind, and that the shift should now become one in which individuals would rise above this. But we also said, it was be also a time when indigenous voice was preeminent, that up until then, the voices of representation always seemed through the filter of a Euro-Canadian artist, a curator, or a Euro-American curator. So the kind of convergence of taking over voice, the change from exhibiting as groupness to one of individuality, and in which voice was struggled for and gained, was what the presence of this moment was all about. So we said that this would be the last exhibition, or should be the last group exhibition. It's not the case, but the point was made. I think the point was made that group exhibitions, you couldn't treat indigenous artists this way any longer, that they're individuals. They come from so many different cultures and backgrounds and practices that just like any Western artist, they must be treated individually. But in some cases, of course, there are many artists who still will go back to groupness. You know, there's an idea, there's a thought, there's the concept that needs to be discussed over and over again. Or there are other artists involved in a kind of a group display or group presentation. So it's not that we completely obliterated, but we felt that the intellectual shift was taking place at that moment, and that we needed to make that point. I think we made the point quite clearly, and artists are, of course, now doing all sorts of things, practicing in any kind of space, and not apologizing to where they're exhibiting. So it could be in an ethnographic museum, an art museum, could be on reservation, could be in somebody's house in a hotel, could be anywhere. So the practices of artists and artistic practices have really shifted and changed, and I think that the artists, certainly in Canada and the U.S., have certainly made that point.
Thank you, Gerald McMaster.